Well, we're out here tonight because we haven't been doing a very good job for you lately.
Towards the end of 2018, after a run of lackluster shows and falling ratings, on an episode of Monday Night Raw, we were treated with the whole McMahon family standing in the middle of the ring, openly admitting that basically the show had sucked in the past few months, and that apparently now we, the WWE Universe, were the authority and the ones in charge. So just how bad of a year was 2018 for WWE for it to lead to this point? Was 2018 really that bad? Let's take a look at some of the main happenings in 2018 and find out. Starting off with our first topic, Roman Reigns. For me, when we think of WWE in the last decade or so, there's only one place to start, and that's with our tribal chief. Although now, in my opinion, he'll go down as one of the GOATs and is doing incredible TV with the bloodline and the crowds eating it all up. As we all know, this was far from the case during the few years after the Shield broke up. Roman was very clearly chosen to be the face of the company, and for good reason. However, this was made far too obvious to the fans, and these fans, being the pre-AEW fanbase, were having absolutely none of it. Roman could have saved a child from a burning building during this time where the crowd was still booing. However, in 2018, the most obvious point of this not working was WrestleMania 34, where Roman Reigns once again faced Lesnar for the Universal Championship. Having already faced him and come up short when we had the infamous Heist of the Century, going into this one, many felt this was the obvious crowning point for Roman to finally win and become champion. Lesnar had already been champ for over a year and was part-time, so it made sense for Roman to win, right? Right? But that wasn't the case. Lesnar eventually won after a fifth F5, and to be honest, at that point, the crowd didn't even care. This wasn't helped by the fact that the show was about 8 hours deep at this point. We had the "this is awful" chants during the match, and after the match, Lesnar, despite winning, was visibly pissed off, throwing the belt at Vince, and Vince responding by letting him know what he thought of him. This was far from over at that point, as not soon after, we were treated with the greatest Royal Rumble event from Saudi Arabia, where these two faced off again, and Roman lost, again. Reigns speared Lesnar through the steel cage the match was held in, then rolled off of Lesnar, touching the floor way before Lesnar did, but what did the ref do? Yep, declare Brock the winner, of course.
Attacking dog. Roman Reigns realizes that.
We had to wait 4 more months until Roman finally won the belt from Lesnar at SummerSlam, with many claiming this was only done so that Lesnar's reign could surpass CM Punk's reign, which at that point was the longest in the modern era. Speaking of Saudi, our next topic is the first ever Crown Jewel event and where to begin with this one. Crown Jewel in 2018 from Saudi Arabia was one of the most controversial shows at the time, and it was so even before the show began. WWE had signed a mega 10-year deal with Saudi to host 2 shows a year, and I think it's fair to say that Saudi Arabia already didn't have the best reputation, and so WWE holding shows there was bound to garner a lot of negative press and views. However, this was taken up to a whole new level after the assassination of Jamal Khashoggi only 1 month before the show was to go ahead. WWE faced pressure from fans, journalists, and even US senators to not only cancel the show, but to cut all ties with Saudi full stop. John Oliver even did this viral piece that tore into and parodied WWE and the pro-Saudi propaganda.
On November 2nd, it's Crown Jewel, live from Saudi Arabia, featuring Brock Lesnar, AJ Styles,
The Undertaker.
No female wrestlers because they aren't allowed to perform there.
And maybe John Cena,
if he's willing to take a major PRP. Try and forget everything you've seen on the news that might make this hard to enjoy.
And instead,
watch the Brothers of Destruction leave their opponents dead and buried. Sorry, poor choice of words.
Despite all this pressure, WWE did not cave in and went ahead with the show anyway. A number of stars apparently refused to work the show. John Cena, who was scheduled and had called it an honor and a privilege to work here, was replaced as he reportedly refused to work the show. Daniel Bryan, who was scheduled to face AJ Styles for the WWE title, had his title match bumped up to an earlier episode of SmackDown and was placed on the Crown Jewel card by Samoa Joe, as he too reportedly refused to work the show. As mentioned, WWE went ahead with the show, citing it was strictly a business decision to do so. Incredibly, they continued to promote the show, but simply erased all references to where the show was held, even during the show. As for the show itself and some of the matches, oh boy. Although we did have some good matches like AJ Styles and Samoa Joe, the most memorable would be the main event for all the wrong reasons. In a throwback to our childhoods, we got D-Generation X versus the Brothers of Destruction. A match that surely would have been incredible even 10 years earlier was not so much here. It was widely reported that with the Saudi shows, the higher-ups at Saudi responsible for these shows influenced who appeared on them, clearly wanting to see stars from years before. It was even reported that they wanted Yokozuna and Ultimate Warrior to appear on the show earlier in the year, not knowing that they were no longer alive to do so. I think we even had a sumo wrestler appear to make up for Yoko in the Greatest Royal Rumble. But I think this would in part explain why this match was put together. For the match itself, anything that could go wrong did. Even the guys involved knew this and were visibly frustrated. HBK also admitted that he regretted coming out of retirement for this match, which was funny since he was the best performer in this match, which to be fair, wasn't saying much. Not long into this near 30-minute match, Triple H tore his pec when going over the top rope from the turnbuckles. This now meant that HBK had to do much of the heavy lifting for his team. Some of the lowlights included a rough-looking whip into the barriers by Triple H, a dead crowd, and then in a first-time-ever moment, I believe, we saw a single punch from HBK to Kane lead to his mask and his hair go flying out the ring. Yep, an overlooking pedigree ended the match, which was just a sad conclusion to a match where our childhood heroes really showed their age. The rest of the show featured a World Cup tournament in which pretty much every competitor was from one country, and so in this tournament that would determine the best in the world, it was obvious who was going to win, right? Yep, you guessed it, Shane McMahon. Lesnar also won the Universal title again, which no one really wanted, and on another note, women weren't allowed to wrestle on this show, which has since changed to be fair. Say what you want, the Saudi shows have gotten significantly better since this one. Moving on to our third topic, AJ Styles and Shinsuke Nakamura's rivalry. After Nakamura won the Royal Rumble, a lot of us fans got the dream match we all wanted as AJ Styles and Nakamura met for the first time in WWE at WrestleMania. Despite having a classic in New Japan, it's fair to say that they struggled to replicate the same magic in this match. You could say the high expectations and maybe the babyface dynamic didn't help them, but still, we really should have got better. The rivalry saw Nakamura turn on AJ Styles after he lost, and then turn into this nut-obsessed crazy man with seemingly every match of theirs ending in a DQ low blow. Nakamura never did win the big one, and this just didn't click for some reason. Years later, it still feels like one that's remembered as what could have been. Moving on to our next topic, Backlash 2018. Giving Crown Jewel a run for its money as the worst pay-per-view of the year, Backlash 2018 was a shocker. It also epitomized the Vince McMahon creative era during the end of the 2010s, where the arguments of him being out of touch couldn't have been more evident. As mentioned here, we saw AJ Nakamura end in a DQ draw with a double nutshot. You just know Vince would have thought that such good shit power. The match of the night actually featured The Miz, who faced Seth Rollins for the IC title. The rest of the card had matches that were average at best, and then we had the main event, Samoa Joe versus Roman Reigns, which on paper could have been excellent. However, the crowd couldn't have cared less at this point. They simply weren't having Roman. The match went 18 minutes and we heard loud chants of CM Punk, Rusev Day, and boring. Much of the crowd have left before the show was even over, and the less said about this show, the better. Moving on, the next topic is Dean Ambrose turning on Seth Rollins and his weird new heel gimmick. During an October episode of Raw, the real sad part of the year came when Roman Reigns announced the return of his leukemia and that he'd have to relinquish the Universal title. The same night saw the other Shield members win the tag team titles, which would have been a nice wholesome way to show support for Roman, but no. Dean Ambrose turned on Seth hitting a dirty deeds, which started his very forgetful heel run, which I think everyone can agree on was tragic, and come to find out even played a large part in him choosing to leave WWE. After turning heel, he started coming out to the ring in this weird Bane mask, claiming everyone in the audience stank and that he didn't want to get infected by them. He even cut this one promo one time while getting a vaccination jab in his bum. He did apparently refuse to go through with what WWE wanted at the time, which was for him to use Roman's cancer in storyline. A heel Dean Ambrose here had great potential but failed to live up to expectations, which was a common theme of WWE in 2018. Again, you just know that the Bane mask and saying that the audience were all diseased was all Vince, and he thought it would be real good shit, pal. During this period, the 3-hour Raws were boring, nothing happening, and featured no real storyline to get us off our seats. And then we got a shocker of a Raw segment with Bobby Lashley and his sisters. On the Raw after WrestleMania in 2018, we saw the return of Bobby Lashley. Not even 6 weeks after his return, Lashley was in a feud with a heel Sami Zayn when he did this incredibly weird interview with Renee Young where he spoke about his 3 older sisters. Watching it, we had no clue where the hell this was all going as he spoke about his 3 sisters and how one of his sisters was attached to a broom, one to a towel and the other to a helmet. But this all made sense in a segment following this when Sami brought out 3 guys dressed as girls, shout out to Max Caster, who he said were his sisters, and then went on to say how Bobby was a bully to his own sisters and an awful brother. The crowd was dead and this segment could perhaps rival the Bayley This Is Your Life segment as one of the worst Raw segments during this era. Some other notable shout outs include Bayley and Sasha Banks rivalry that never really happened. As great as it was to see Dr. Shelby again, Banks and Bayley's storyline from going from friends to enemies and back to friends again really missed the mark and left people confused. We also had the fabulous Moolah controversy at WrestleMania where fans revolted at the idea of the Women's Battle Royal being named after her. There was even a petition to remove her name and sponsors like Snickers publicly expressed their disappointment before WWE eventually removed her name from this. Speaking of WrestleMania, 2018 was also the year where we got the dream match that we all wanted, John Cena versus The Undertaker. Except, it really wasn't. It was a squash match that lasted 2.5 minutes and had seemed to be put there only to give Taker a quick win and boost his confidence. Although it was really cool to see John Cena actually attend WrestleMania as a fan and legit sit amongst them even before the show began. During this period, it also felt like Baron Corbin was all over every show. He became the constable and then the GM of Raw for like 2 years and was involved in some insufferable long segments. Going back to where we started in this video, in storyline, it was him that got the blame when the authority admitted that Raw sucked and the ratings had been tanking. With all that being said, however, it would be remiss of me not to mention many of the positives of 2018, of which there were quite a few that really stood out. One of these positives has to be Ronda Rousey's debut. After the first ever Women's Royal Rumble in 2018, Ronda Rousey made her surprise debut at the end of the match. Coming off a few losses in the UFC, Ronda was still a major star and was put in a feud with the Authority, Triple H and Stephanie McMahon. In March, it was announced that her first match at WrestleMania would be a mixed tag against those two, and after initial rumours of The Rock being her partner to follow up on an angle they did on WrestleMania a few years before this, Kurt Angle ended up as a partner instead. As a side note, during this feud is when we got this iconic image, which is still one of the greatest images in wrestling, fact. The match itself blew all expectations and stole the show. It turned out better than it had any right to be. Ronda shined throughout as designed and even put Triple H in his place, eventually tapping out Stephanie with an armbar to win. Say what you want about her now, but her debut match in 2018 was definitely a standout moment. Speaking of Ronda Rousey, let's talk about her arch nemesis Becky Lynch. It's still crazy to me that they never did have that one-on-one match. Anyways, we can't forget that during the build to the 2018 Survivor Series, Becky Lynch had her face and nose broken by Nia Jax. This led to the now iconic visual of Becky bloodied up in the crowd, laughing and taunting the other wrestlers, looking like a total badass. Prior to this, Becky had been slowly getting over more and more each week, but during this segment, we got to see the first incarnation of the man, which served as a launchpad for Becky to go on and at one point be the most popular superstar in the whole company. Although unplanned and she would have been annoyed at the time, this was one of the best things that could have happened to her and her career. This next one might be a bit of a mixed one and depends on your opinion. In 2016, due to injury, Daniel Bryan announced his retirement from wrestling. After being one of the most over superstars just a few years before this, this was a huge shock and disappointment to everyone. Which is why it was all the more sweet when in March 2018, after getting cleared, Daniel Bryan announced he was back. However, soon after he returned, he was in a feud with Big Cass, which was largely forgettable. And after that, he was in a feud with The Miz, which played off the back of the great talking smack segment between the two, but again, felt a bit underwhelming. But then, this all changed after Daniel Bryan won the WWE title from AJ Styles and turned heel in the process. We got a version of Daniel Bryan that, although it was short-lived, was excellent and really tapped into his real-life persona. Speaking of excellent, on a side note, Daniel Bryan had this incredible match with Brock Lesnar at the 2018 Survivor Series. Although it was heel versus heel, the match was insane and some of the near falls for Bryan were a sight to behold. But moving on after that, Bryan started cutting these promos calling the fans fickle and saying that the Yes Movement was dead. He started speaking about earth pollution caused by all the fans. There was this one promo with Mustafa Ali where he scolded him for driving an SUV. This angry vegan shtick was gold. He stated how all his merch was secondhand recycled and cooked the fans each week. This gimmick was amazing and it was a shame it only lasted a few months. We got to see a unique side of Daniel Bryan and a gimmick that probably shouldn't have really worked was genius and absolutely did work. But moving on to some other notable shoutouts. During the summer of 2018, we briefly had a Shield reunion which was great. NXT in 2018 under Triple H was also killing it with some insane pay-per-views that many felt were miles clear of the main roster. Adam Cole and the Undisputed Era was one of the key highlights here. We also had the first ever WWE all-women's pay-per-view called Evolution, which featured a classic between Becky Lynch and Charlotte Flair. In 2018, we also got the Ultimate Deletion match between Woken Matt Hardy and Bray Wyatt. Broken Matt Hardy and his cinematic matches were probably the best things to happen to TNA in decades, and so it was intriguing how this would work in WWE. The match itself was great and almost felt surreal seeing it in WWE. Bray and Matt would then go on to be a tag team and in my opinion were great together. And anytime Samoa Joe is reading a bedtime story and delivering it only in a way that he can, sign me up, you know it's great TV. In late summer of 2018, the feud between Samoa Joe and AJ Styles on SmackDown was great. Samoa Joe was absolutely killing it during this run. As mentioned, he did this amazing promo reading a bedtime story. He invaded AJ's house. And yeah, there was this moment.
Oh, Randy!
He was obsessed with AJ Styles' wife and family. It really was a rivalry that helped make SmackDown much, much better to watch Raw during this period. And finally, in 2018, we got the greatest entrance into a Royal Rumble match you'll ever see.
O'Neal! I just had a very busy week here in Saudi Arabia. He's had dinner with many princes and very important people. And he
Oh my God, what the heck? What a Titus!
So there you have it. I'm sure there's a ton more of stuff I could have added to both the bad and good side of 2018. But overall, was 2018 a bad year for WWE? I'll let you guys be the judge of that below. I think it's universally agreed that WWE now is miles better than in 2018. So let me know below your thoughts and also what year in WWE you'd like me to review next. Be sure to subscribe as well and I'll catch you on the next one.